Penguin Random House Audio presents The Place We Make, Breaking the Legacy of Legalized Hate. Foreword, written and read by Chanté Griffin. This is the author, Sarah L. Sanderson. The author is donating 90% of the proceeds from this book to Oregon Black Pioneers, Equal Justice Initiative, the Crete Collective, the Red Door Project, Native American Youth and Family Center of Portland, and other organizations that benefit people of color. For Loy, who is finally done running, and for Jaden, who's just getting started. No free Negro or mulatto not residing in this state at the time of the adoption of this Constitution shall come, reside, or be within this state, or hold any real estate, or make any contracts, or maintain any suit therein. And the Legislative Assembly shall provide by penal laws for the removal by public officers of all such Negroes and mulattoes, and for their effectual exclusion from the state, and for the punishment of persons who shall bring them into the state, or employ, or harbor them. Amendment to the Oregon State Constitution, 1857, Oregon State Archives. The only thing about Oregon that is unique is that they were bold enough to write it down. Walida E. Marisha, Why Aren't There More Black People in Oregon? A Hidden History.
Foreword. As the United States struggles to find its footing during this era of racial reckoning, throughout the book publishing industry and beyond, a question looms large. Is there space for white voices? Given that the publishing industry has historically marginalized voices of color, should there be space for a white woman to write a book that documents racism toward Black people and Native Americans, especially when said racism was proliferated by her relatives? These questions are critical. Yet I humbly suggest there are two more questions to ask. Should there be space for voices that cry out to repent and repair? And who ultimately benefits when these voices speak out? I believe that answering the latter questions helps answer the former ones. I met Sarah L. Sanderson in the summer of 2022 when she attended the Writing with God virtual retreat I co-lead with poet V'Lynn Brown, a fellow Black writer. V'Lynn had invited Sarah, who is knee-deep in writing The Place We Make, to set up a consultation with me during the retreat. I imagine Sarah wanted to meet with me because I'm a journalist who writes extensively about how race intersects with various aspects of U.S. culture, including faith. During our time together, Sarah's internal turmoil was evident. A part of her felt drawn to writing this book, but another part wondered if hers was the right voice to tell the story. Am I doing what my ancestors have done before me? Taking ownership and command of stories and lands that aren't ours to touch in the first place? In The Place We Make, Sarah examines Oregon's exclusion laws that banned Black people from living within its borders and details how, in 1851, a successful businessman named Jacob Vanderpool was expelled from living and making a living in Oregon City, a town only minutes from Sarah's current home, simply because he was Black. Throughout the book, Sarah takes readers back in time to witness how the intersecting forces of racism, greed, and silence forcibly removed Vanderpool from Oregon City, prevented other Black people from settling in the state, and stole land from the Clackamas tribe who resided there. While speaking with Sarah and reading The Place We Make, I was struck by her humility toward the book's topics. Instead of positioning herself as a heroine, she took the posture of a learner and truth-teller, regardless of how bad it makes her or her family look. As a reader and fellow writer, I appreciated her candor and vulnerability. And as a Christian, I especially appreciated how she publicly grappled with how to repair what she and her ancestors have breached. Should there be space for voices that cry out to repent and repair? Absolutely. After reading The Place We Make, I believe Sarah L. Sanderson is one of those voices. And to answer the question about who ultimately benefits when these voices speak out, well, we all benefit. Displaced Black Oregonians, all of Oregon's residents, racial justice advocates, as well as students of history who want to connect the dots between our past and our present. I, for one, can count on my hand the number of Black people I saw in the Beaver State the one time I visited. Now I know why. History buffs, activists, and those who seek to repair the breaches racism forged will also appreciate this tenderly delivered book. It's a beautiful rendering of an ugly history, a worthy read among the myriad of race books published in recent years. I am honored to introduce you to it. Chanté Griffin, advocate, journalist, and author.
Introduction. Let us take a knife and cut the world in two and see what worms are eating at the rind. Langston Hughes, Tired, The Collected Poems of Langston Hughes. What do you notice around you at this moment? Someone's shoulder, perhaps, as they brush past you in the bookstore? Library shelves? Tired bodies folded into subway seats? Your grandmother's quilt draped over your toes? The edge of your beach towel? Or the ever-shifting edge where sand meets water? Wherever you are in the world, whether surrounded by evergreens or palm trees or a thicket of office towers, whether sitting in a waiting room or an aisle seat or nestled on your living room couch, thank you for bringing me along to this place you call here. I do not know it the way you do. I do not know the name of the baby whose cry will light up the monitor any second now, or the names of the cows in your barn, or the name of the woman who drives your bus. I don't know the names of the laborers who built the building in which you're sitting, or the names of the children who played in that very spot thousands of years before anyone thought to build there at all. I can only tell you what I discovered when I began to be curious about my place. This is the story of what I learned when I began to wonder about the place where I live, who made it, and why, and how it all came to be. When you leave the thought place we make together in the sharing of these pages and return to the real place of dishes and deadlines and bills, I hope you will carry some of my questions with you. I wonder what you will find if you do. Originally, I wanted to write about Jacob Vanderpool, the only Black man living in the tiny frontier town of Oregon City in 1851. Oregon was the only state admitted to the Union with anti-Black exclusion laws on its books. Jacob Vanderpool was the only person ever expelled from Oregon under the application of those laws. He was, in fact, the only person in the history of the United States ever convicted and punished solely for the crime of being Black. The singularity of that fact riveted me. The only state, the only man. Throughout the vast history of injustice, rolling down like a mighty river across this nation, from century to century and sea to shining sea, here, I thought, was a story small enough for me to hold. As I began to ask questions, I grew concerned that the evidence available for Jacob Vanderpool's story might be too small to give a satisfactory account. The social ramifications of his story were certainly immense. His life itself had surely been as large and full and valuable as every other human life. But history seemed to have hidden its records. The known facts were maddeningly few. Vanderpool had been a sailor. He turned his hand to hotel management in June 1851. He stood trial in August under the exclusion law. By the end of September, he'd been expelled from the Oregon Territory. I dug and poked, but could not discover where Vanderpool had lived before he came to Oregon or where he went after. Nothing was said about whom he had loved or what he had cherished.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.